Okay, hi. It's an honor to be here tonight and to be the third part of the old joke about a political scientist, a lawyer, and a mathematician walk into a bar. And I'm gonna actually, it's also great to get to go last because I get to show you some pictures and charts that that address some of the issues that we've heard about from the previous two speakers. So let me get to it. I wanna think about some gerrymandering metrics, how to measure, and what's the baseline. And let's get started. Okay, first I wanna make this a math problem in some way. So here's Wisconsin. You might recognize it in green and recognize it a little less in the second picture. What we see here is a graph that shows some units that you might use to build a map from. Those could be census blocks, block groups, or tracts. They could be precincts or wards. And that will vary depending on how you build your plan. Then what's our task when we redistrict is to split up that graph while meeting a list of criteria. And some of those are universal for the whole country, like the Voting Rights Act, and some are specified by states. Okay, so let's talk about symmetry. I have some pictures to go along with the description that you heard a little earlier. So again, symmetry, as we heard from Gary King, is the idea that how one party performs with a certain vote share should be handled symmetrically were the other party to get the same vote share. So let's look at some pictures. So we see here various states, and these are pictures put together by my colleague Mira Bernstein, I want to say. So what we see here are some states and their 2016 maps. This one here is Wisconsin 2012 in its state senate. What's going on in these pictures? So we have these two axes, and we've heard about seats versus votes. You see votes along the x-axis, so it's the share of votes that a party received, and then against that you plot the proportion of seats that it got in whatever body it is that you're considering. Okay, so there's something I really want to emphasize. If you have the outcome of a single election, then a priori you're dealing with just one point on this grid. You get just one vote total and just one seat outcome. You get a single point. But what we heard alluded to before is that there are various ways, a variety of interesting ways, to turn that into a whole curve. These pictures here are made with a hypothesis called uniform partisan swing, where you take the outcome of a particular election and you add or subtract off Democrat and Republican vote share in each district and see how it would perform under variance of the actual outcome in that year. Okay, so then the question we're asking ourselves about these pictures, and happily it's a very graphically understandable one, is how symmetric is the picture? Is it the case that what we see above is in mirror image represented below, right? That's the symmetry question. If Democrats got some proportion over here and we were to flip the proportion, would the outcome have been the same for the other side? So Minnesota looks pretty good for symmetry, right? Is that making sense from these pictures? Great, and up here there's an actual simulation. This doesn't come from an actual state, this comes from neutral sampling, and that one looks pretty symmetric. And then we see some that look a little less symmetric. Here's Ohio, Florida, and here's that Wisconsin State Senate. Okay, and so the whole idea is partisan symmetry should penalize these curves when they deviate from being symmetrical. So let's see what that amounts to. So I'm zooming in on Wisconsin. How might you measure that? Lots of ways you could do it. Here are two. You could see how big that distance is, and you could see how big that distance is. Okay, let me say why those are things. A symmetrical plan, one thing you can say about it for sure is that it better go through 50-50, right? If you get exactly half the vote share, you better get half the seat share. That's the only thing that's symmetrically valid at that level. And so the green and the yellow here, what they measure, is two ways of saying how far you are from going through 50-50. Make sense? This one is sometimes called partisan bias. This one sometimes is called the mean median test, and they have other names. But there are lots of statistical tests for measuring how far off you are from symmetric. Okay, so I've just kind of overviewed with pictures some exactly of what you heard about a moment ago. And this is a fairly robust approach to how you might want to measure the level of gerrymandering. Let's do something totally different. Let's talk about this thing called the efficiency gap that maybe you heard a lot about if you followed the Wisconsin case. What is it? Well, it's also got to do with the conversion of votes to seats. And in just 3 minutes, I could tell you how it's built. But I don't need to do that because I have a picture that does all the work for me. Okay? So I'm about to show you this picture. Here's what it does. It gives you a permissible zone of this plot. Right? It says an election will be a point that falls somewhere in this plot. I'm going to show you the permissible zone. Ready? There it is. That's the efficiency gap test. What I've shown you here, there should be an absolute value there, but otherwise it's right, is where the efficiency gap is less than 8%, which is the test that's been proposed. And so when you fall out of that zone, you fail through the eyes of efficiency gap. I think this is the shortest way to explain it that I've ever seen. Okay, so let me give an example that shows one property of efficiency gap. It's really different from proportional representation. Proportional representation is this perfect slope one seats votes curve, where, for instance, you say 60% of the votes should get 60% of the seats. That's proportional representation. That falls on this slope one curve. Note that it falls outside the permissibility zone. Okay, so any election in which 60% of the votes gets you 60% of the seats will be rated impermissible by this score. Okay, that's efficiency gap. Now I want to talk about a third one that's fairly new. It's still coming together. It seems quite interesting. It also seems quite complicated. I want to see how I can do at pitching it to you in the 2 minutes and 7 seconds that I have left. Okay, how does sampling work? So, remember our goal. Our goal is to take a graph and to split it up into some number of districts. And what you see in this picture is a very small graph being split up into 4 districts represented by the different colors that you see here. What you can do is random walk around the space of all partitions. Just take a map and start flipping units from district to district. Flip, 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 and then do that a bajillion times. That's the technical mathematical term. Okay, doing it in this way, such as with a method called Markov chain Monte Carlo, or MCMC, you can sample thousands of maps, you can sample millions of maps, you can get lots of possible ways that you could have drawn the lines out of this. Okay? That's sampling. What do you do with it? Well, the proposal is that it helps with this baseline and thresholding problem that's been discussed. So here's a picture pulled from a paper of Mattingly et al. Of how that Wisconsin assembly map performed compared to the 20,000 that were sampled by an algorithm like the one you saw on the previous slide. So here's the picture. So this is the Wisconsin State Assembly in 2012. And along the top, you see the number of Republican seats produced. This is out of a total of 99, okay? So look, it's a bell curve. Nature loves a bell curve. You get this histogram of possibilities anywhere from just below 50 seats to somewhere just above 60 seats, with the mode somewhere here around 55, and there's the assembly's actual map. Okay, what's that saying? That's saying it's an outlier. That's saying it's more extreme in its partisan outcome than, in this case, 99%+ of all the possible ways you could have sliced and diced the map. And that's the power of this extreme outlier standard, and that's a phrase that you heard batted around in the oral arguments in the Whitford case last month, and it's a possibility for a standard that could emerge from that analysis. Okay, so let me summarize. I've talked about 3 approaches, and I want to say, actually, importantly, this isn't a trichotomy. These 3 approaches can be compatible with each other. For instance, you could sample and then measure the efficiency gap of your ensemble. You could sample and then measure partisan symmetry. So you can mix and match these approaches. Nonetheless, I've tried to describe 3 intellectually distinct approaches. And there are pros and cons for each. Each has strengths in particular. For partisan symmetry, I think it's really easy to make the case for fairness. And you heard that case made very eloquently a few moments ago. And it uses very, you know, cutting edge principles from statistics and political science. And there's a lot of consensus behind it. Efficiency gap. Something that's interesting about efficiency gap is that it seems to derive, rather than prescribe, a shape in that seats votes curve. It offers a single score and a standard threshold, and it's easy to run. So you won't have, well, you might still have battles of the experts, to be honest, because you have to worry about which data to use and how to deal with uncontested races. But it's fairly easy to run, and it seems to provide a nice, manageable standard. And then you have the sampling approach and outliers, And the great strength of the final approach is that it gives a baseline that's specific to each state. It thinks about the law of each state. It thinks about the political geography of each state. The fact that in Wisconsin, Democrats are densely arranged in Milwaukee, but in Alaska, they're spread throughout the rural parts of the state. And it produces very intuitive visuals. So hopefully this has been a helpful overview to various different approaches. Thank you.